Once we have the experience and the corresponding knowledge, we can categorize the experience into two basic categories: that which is true and that which is false. That which is true usually points to something positive as expected, useful and certain, more consistent and logical. And the false category points to something which is negative, not as expected, shaky, unreliable, uncertain. We do this kind of categorization based on some chosen criteria. Now the question comes, what are these criteria and who chooses them? Who decides what is true and what is not? And what are the rules to fix these criteria? And you will very quickly find that the criteria are chosen by the person who is categorizing, and the person does it as per his liking. So the criteria for the truth are subjective and arbitrary. I've already made a long video about the truth of the truth, which you must have seen in the transmission series. So I'm not going to repeat everything in detail here. I'm just going to give you an overview of it again. The question comes, why categorize the experience? Why is there a need? And there can be many reasons for that. Perhaps you want to take an action on the knowledge. Perhaps you want to decide something. And the truth is related to certainty, our desire to achieve some outcome. So the more certain we are, the better actions can be taken to get the desired outcome. If we are not certain, we know that the actions can fail to achieve that outcome. So we want to predict, actually, through this categorization, what will be the outcome of our actions. And then we find the suitable criteria. We make it up. It is arbitrary. We apply that criteria and then we classify the experience and decide on an action based on the knowledge that's gained. So for example, you want to buy some gold. Now you need to find out whether the gold is genuine, is not fake, some other metal. So you choose some criteria, some tests, and do those tests. Check what is your experience, check what is your knowledge, and you decide whether the gold is real or not. If it falls in the category of truth, you say, okay, I'm going to spend money on it. If it falls in the category of false, you say, no, I don't want to buy this. So the actions are decided based on this categorization, based on this classification. And the criteria we use for declaring something as true or false, they keep changing. So because the criteria are so flexible and subjective, it is possible that something which is true for one person in one situation can be false for somebody else in another situation. There can be a difference of opinion regarding what is true and what is not. So the true and false are not something which is fundamental. The true and false is cooked up on the spot depending on our requirements. We can be more precise in that, or we can be loose about it. For example, when we go and see a movie based on somebody else's review, we are not so much critical about whether the review is true or not. We are very loose about this situation. But when we want to buy a property, we double check everything, all the papers, the locality, and we take legal opinions and so on. Here we become very strict because the consequences are going to be more severe compared to the situation of the movie. So true and false are not something built into the nature, built into this universe. They are not written in stone. They are very, very flexible, very subjective, and very arbitrary. However, we still do this categorization. It adds to our knowledge of our experiences and makes us perform better actions. Although sometimes we come to know later that our categorization was defective. It does not matter what are your criteria. The true and false can be reversed anytime because new experiences arise, new situations arise all the time. So this categorization is a strategy of the mind to predict something, that's all. Nothing is really true and nothing is really false. These things are very flexible. Now after knowing that, it boils down to the question of what criteria should I choose to categorize my experiences. we do this a lot in philosophy, so it becomes important for us to choose a good criteria to arrive at truth, to arrive at certain laws, rules, understanding. We are trying to find consistency in chaos. So it becomes very important. And the answer is very simple. Choose that which gives you more knowledge, which leads to decisions that are more productive and logical. And then it is left to the person, it is left to the seeker to decide the criteria. However, there are some guidelines, as we have already discussed, the similar guidelines regarding the means for knowledge, because sometimes we may want to equate knowledge with truth, that I know such and such thing and it falls in the category of truth, and that's why it is more important. And we may want to discard anything, any knowledge that falls in the category of false. So there can be two kinds of criteria, the inferior criteria and the superior criteria. We have already seen some examples of blind beliefs that lead to inferior criteria, adoption of inferior criteria. There can be some examples, like if your parents say that this is true, that is false. If your friends say, if people in general say, authorities, leaders, media, rumors, what are they trying to say? They're trying to tell you what is true according to their own criteria. And this should not be simply adopted without thinking. They can lead to wrong actions. They can lead to loss. They can lead to ignorance instead of knowledge. So we have already seen that if a book says that something is true, it does not become true. Probably there were criteria used in the book which are not so strict, or it is simply made up false stories. Similarly, it does not become true because a lot of people are saying it. It does not become true because it is old. It is not true because you want it to be true, imagine it to be true. If you are deluded that this is true, and so on. An ordinary person, an ignorant person, uses these criteria to find out what is true and what is false. And therefore, their lives are miserable, their intelligence is super low, and the actions they take mostly fail. They are living a miserable life, enslaved by those who dictate what is true. They do not have capability to find out what is true, what is false on their own, simply because they are borrowing criteria from other people. It is possible to turn something which is false into true simply by redefining the criteria, as we have noted in the earlier video. So these are inferior criteria. The inferior criteria by definition are totally unreliable. People use inferior criteria because they do not know anything better. So what is superior criteria then? Your own experience is the first. If you experience something as true most of the time, you can confidently take an action on that. You need to find out through experiment what is true, what is not true. The second is logic. If it is illogical, irrational, probably it's false. If an experience happens consistently in the same way most of the time, we can categorize it as truth. It is true that the sun comes up every day and there will be morning tomorrow also. This is based on our experience and consistency. If we do an experiment and the results come out to be same most of the time, then we say it is true. This is the repeatability. If the results cannot be repeated often, then probably that hypothesis or the theory or your expectation is false. If you get desired outcomes most of the time, that means that experience is reliable, that action is reliable, and then we can classify it as truth. Another good criteria is objectivity, which means the experience appears in more or less the same way to many people. Probably I am deluded, probably I am seeing it in a wrong way, but if many people agree on something, then this doubt can be removed. This is the objectivity. If the results of an experiment are independent of time and place, that is, the results do not change from time to time and they do not change from one place to another, they remain same all the time in any place, they're more certain, and that makes them true. A very important criteria is immutability, which means the truth, once established, does not often change. If it changed, it was not true. It may happen during our life experience that some things which we thought were true they change. And then the true becomes the false. So in ideal cases, that which never changes is the most certain thing. It holds on in all the situations, subjectively, objectively, very consistent, very repeatable, very logical. And it is there in all the time and at all places. That makes it super true. Immutability is a very strong criteria, actually. So a wise man will use all this criteria to establish truth of something, truth of an experience, truth of a claim, and then will take an action. And so the action will be more productive. He will be more certain. He will be more confident. And such actions will bring fruits. And like the ignorant person who just willy-nilly assumes what is true, hears from here and there, reads from here and there, and then takes random actions, wishy-washy actions. Their life remains a chaos, while those who use better criteria, as listed here, they achieve something. Their lives are very stable, happy, orderly. And when they speak, the intelligence shows up. So simply by tweaking your criteria for truths, you can make a very big difference. It is of worldly importance also, not only in the spiritual or philosophical field. Now, you can imagine that when your life goal is knowledge or truth, and you want to be free from all that is false, you must choose the strictest possible criteria. Now, you cannot be loose about it. Otherwise, you will end up in ignorance again and again and again. So the more strict the criteria are, more certain is your knowledge, more true it is. There is less chance of it getting changed depending on situations and other things. So after knowing the importance of choosing a superior set of criteria for classifying our experiences as true or false, we can set up a criteria for truth on the path of knowledge. And it is very simple. We choose that which is ultimate, which is the most strict. We call all that which is unchanging as true, and we call that which changes as false. There is nothing more strict than this criteria. So while classifying our experiences, we are actually merciless. We use this hard division here. We notice an experience that is unchanging and we say it is true. We say it is reality. We say it is that which really exists. If we see something which changes, no matter how slow, it may change in a million years, but we call it false. We call it illusion. We call it appearance. It is not non-existent, but it exists only in form of an appearance. It is soon going to become something else. And it was something else when we started the observation. And right now also, in the middle, it is changing. It is not that which we concluded. So it must be kept in mind that this is a chosen criteria. This is not written in stone. This is not a rule of the existence or something like that. You can modify it, and that there will be consequences of it. You may arrive at something which is more certain, or you may arrive at something which is less certain, depending on the need. And you can see that sometimes it can become very, very impractical. So the train is moving, the train is changing, it was not there, and it will not be there. So my actions, which involve traveling in the train, should I take it or not? Because it is changing, it is false, so I better not get on the train. And it becomes really impractical. So in the day-to-day life, we adopt a less strict criteria for truth. We allow a concession there. It is called relative truth. We say the illusion is also true sometimes, just to allow the actions here. And ordinary people use this kind of criteria a lot, but sometimes a seeker also uses the relative truth. There are occasions when a seeker will not understand the ultimate truth, will not understand very abstract or complex concepts. So we start from something which is less true, which according to our experience does not hold. And then slowly we introduce the more fundamental aspects once the student is more familiar and comfortable with the relative ones. Then we proceed to the absolute ones. Makes the teachings very easy to understand. If you start at the level of the student, whatever he considers as true and false, you start there and then make tiny changes till you arrive at the final truth according to our super strict criteria. And sometimes, just like I said, there are practical reasons. Somebody tells you that, don't believe this person. His character is suspicious. And now, because you have important things to do in your life, you cannot devote months and months of your time to find out whether this person is reliable or not. You simply adopt the belief from somebody else. Get the things done practically. Do not worry too much about what is true about that person. So these kind of truths, they fall in the category of relative truths. They are temporary in nature. They must be discarded. Then you will encounter such teachers who told you yesterday that, look, this thing, X is true. And today you went to him and he said, no, X is false, the Y is true. Tomorrow he may change that also. And now you will think, what kind of teacher is this? The truth keeps changing. And what is happening here is he's taking you step by step. He's introducing you to your own experience in a stepwise fashion. He is working in the relative truth. When he stops changing his statements, that will be the final truth. Usually it happens that the relative truths are very complex. It takes like a whole book to understand what is being said there. But the final truth, the ultimate truth, is very simple. It is one line or two line only. So why do we do that? Why don't the teachers tell you the final? Actually, they do, but very few people can grasp it. And the reason is the presence of all kinds of beliefs and assumptions. Either they do not understand it, or it is too simple to accept as truth, because in the mind of an average seeker, the truth has to be colorful and like explosive firecrackers in the sky. They have a lot of expectations about the nature of the truth and the nature of the existence. They expect magical things. And when those are not told, and their progress stops, because their own beliefs, their own expectations, they cause a retardation in their progress. So the teacher needs to adopt some techniques, tricks to bring the seeker closer to the truth one step at a time. And then the seeker, as his intellect matures, he gets it finally. On the path of knowledge, we start with the ultimate truth. And then we wait for the fallout to happen. Because most of the time it will be denied. It will not be understood. And then we wait for that mind to ask questions. And through the series of answers, questions and answers, the final thing is demonstrated as the truth. And this is done by breaking down the beliefs, breaking down the assumptions. So in my opinion, this takes very less time. Sometimes it can take only a day or a week or a month, that's all, depending on the interest and intensity of the seeker. So I'm also going to change lanes when it comes to the matter of truth. Sometimes I will say, this is true, that is true. And when it is settled, when the common sense and practical things are out of the way, then that which is extraordinary will be revealed. And you will find it is probably more ordinary than the ordinary life. There is a category of truths which are purely abstract and logical in nature. For example, mathematics and pure logic. They will sharpen your mind. The logical abilities and the mathematical abilities, they are good training exercises for the mind. So when I say truth, I'm actually most of the time talking about an experience which is grounded, not abstract. There are mathematical truths. They serve as a tool. And when I talk about truths, generally I'm not talking about these things. So there can be many kinds of teachings depending on how the truth is revealed. By that I mean pointing out to your own experiences and letting you decide what falls where, in which category. There can be many systems of teachings. Some are bottom-up. They start from where you are in total ignorance and do some corrective operations. And then they gradually reduce the ignorance. What we are doing here is we are taking a top-down approach, which is exactly reverse of this. We introduce the truth first and then demonstrate that all the beliefs can be dropped in the light of these teachings. We go from the most basic to the details. So that is interesting as well as very fascinating and shocking sometimes. And it's very fast. That is why this is called direct path. Usually, the mind is capable of solving the problem of ignorance by itself. Sometimes the ignorance is like a glass. all it needs is one blow and then everything is shattered. And sometimes the ignorance is like clay. You need to etch away a little lump here and a little lump there. So depending on the mental makeup of the student, the realization of what is true, what is false can be immediate, instant, or it can take a little bit of time where it is then stepwise revealed. So this is what I'm going to call as the multi-tiered teachings, where if required, the teacher can drop down to the lower level to match with that of the student, depending on the grasping power of that seeker, intelligence of that seeker, his past experience, and lack or presence of the qualities that we discussed. Sometimes, you know, we may start with something which is totally false because that is what the student is capable of at that time. And we patiently wait till the student questions. And as soon as the student is ready, teacher climbs up a level. So if the teachings are taking time to materialize, the reason is the student. It is not that the teachings themselves are slow. It is that the students are slow. So as you must have noticed, we are already doing that. We are going towards the bottom now. So every video that comes in this series takes you lower and lower. And will go to the lowest actually. In some situation, the absolute false will be called as truth. And things will be explained there. The glass may shatter at any episode. For some, the first episode was whole and complete. Nothing remains to be known after that. But if you're watching this, the ignorance can shatter at any time, in any step, while going downwards.